Let's work through the following optimization problem together. Here's the situation. Liz is standing on the bank of a 30-foot-wide river. An ice cream shop is located 150 feet downriver on the opposite bank of the river. Liz plans to get to the ice cream shop by a combination of swimming across the river to a point X feet downriver on the opposite bank and jogging the rest of the way along the river. She can swim at a rate of 6 feet per second and can jog at a rate of 7 feet per second. To what point on the opposite bank should she swim to reach the ice cream shop in the least amount of time? Okay, so that's pretty overwhelming sounding. But this is actually a really famous type of optimization problem. This is just kind of like a standard problem that you always see in the optimization section of a calculus book. So let's try to break this down and figure out how to solve a problem like this. Okay, so the first thing to do in any optimization problem is to, after you read the problem carefully, to attempt to sort of summarize and dissect the information by drawing a good diagram or picture. And so here I kind of already have the outline of a picture. So we have Liz, who's on the bank of a river, and ultimately she wants to reach the ice cream shop, which you see over here. And then she's going to take some diagonal path across the river, right? She's going to swim across the river, and then she's going to reach the bank and jog the rest of the way. So that's that path outlined in black here. But there's a little bit more information in the problem than what's shown on the picture. So let's try and fill in the details. Okay, so first of all, it says that Liz is standing on the bank of a 30-foot wide river. Okay, so the river's 30 feet wide, so let's fill in that detail, right? This is 30 feet. Okay, and an ice cream shop is located 150 feet downriver on the opposite side of the bank. Okay, so this distance, right, from where Liz is to the ice cream shop is 150 feet. Okay, what else? So she plans to get to the ice cream shop by a combination of swimming across the river to a point X feet downriver on the opposite bank. Okay, so she swims across the river, right? That's this portion outlined here. She's swimming across the river. And then it's kind of assigning the variable for us already, right? It says to a point X feet downriver. Okay, so what it's telling us then is this distance, the distance she swims downriver, is X. And then she's going to jog the rest of the way along the river. Okay, so we've got X, right? X is a distance from where Liz is to where she lands on the riverbank. And then, you know, we've got 150 feet as a total distance from the ice cream shop. So we could also label this part of her journey, the part that she's actually running, to be 150 minus X, right? Okay, so this completes our picture, and this is a great starting point. We've established our variables, right? We've got X, and then we've got our distances labeled, and we've got a good sense of what's going on here in the problem. So let's then continue with the next step of the optimization process. The next step in our process is to identify what we're actually trying to either minimize or maximize, and then write some sort of equation involving that quantity. Okay, so let's see, what are we actually trying to minimize or maximize here? Well, the final sentence gives that away. It says, to what point on the opposite bank should she swim to reach the ice cream shop in the least amount of time? Okay, so what we're trying to do then is ultimately we want to minimize time travel, right? The time it takes her to travel there, we want to minimize that time. So we need some sort of expression for the time that it takes her to travel to the ice cream shop. Okay, so how are we going to get that expression for time? So what have we given in this problem? What kind of quantities? We're given distances, right? We're given several distances, 30 feet across the river, 100 feet to the ice cream shop, you know, and then she's landing at some distance along the riverbank. So we're given lots of distances. What else are we given? Kind of in the middle of the problem here, we're given some rates, right? She can swim at a rate of 6 feet per second and can jog at a rate of 7 feet per second. Okay, so we have distances and rates, and we want to know something about time. Okay, so that kind of suggests a relationship that we might want to use here. So remember that distance, which I'm going to use a D for that, equals rate times time. It may be a while since you've used that formula, but it makes sense, right? Distance equals rate times time. So we're interested in time, right? So if I solve for time here, I get time equals distance over rate. So that's going to be our equation that we're going to be focusing on here, that we actually want to optimize, is the time. Okay? Now there's kind of two different times. So let me back up a step. Time equals distance over rate. So that's good. That's a good starting point. But it's still maybe a little simpler. There's a lot of information in this problem, and we want to somehow incorporate all these different rates and distances. So let's think a little bit more about the time. There's a time she spends swimming and the time she spends running. So I'm going to write this as time equals time sub s plus time sub r, just to represent that there's two different things that are contributing to this time, swimming time and running time. Okay, so then I can use a distance over rate for each of those times. So it's going to look like this. Okay, and let me use capital R's here. So this is just saying the time equals the distance swimming over the swimming rate plus the distance running over the running rate. So we're just basically taking that time and breaking it up into two pieces. So now we've got an outline for a formula, but we need to actually fill in what these distances and rates are in terms of the variables we established and the information given to us in the original problem. Okay, so let's start with ds, which is the distance that she's going to swim. So let's go back up to our picture and look at that. So here where I have this blue line, that's the distance she's swimming. So we can find an expression for that in terms of x by using this right triangle that we see in our picture. So one side of the triangle is 30 feet, the other is a variable x. So if we use Pythagorean theorem, this side's going to be the square root of 30 squared plus x squared. Okay, so that's the distance she swims. So I can plug that into my formula. 30 squared plus x squared. What's the rate that she swims? Well, we just get that from the original problem. It says 6 feet per second. So this is going to be over 6 plus, okay, what's the distance she runs? Let's consult our picture again. So the way we've established our variables, the distance she's going to run is going to be 150 minus x feet. Okay, so 150 minus x, and the rate that she's running at is given in the problem to be 7. Okay, so now we finally have an expression for the time it takes her to reach the ice cream shop in terms of a variable x. Okay, so what's the next step in the problem? The next step in the problem is to identify any sort of constraints that we might have. Okay, so these constraints are often additional equations, but they don't have to be. Sometimes it's just restrictions on the variables. So let's kind of look back at our situation here. First of all, let's just make sure there's not any additional information given to us in the problem. So we're told about the width of the river, where the ice cream shop is, you know, how she's swimming across the river, jogging the rest of the way. We've got our rates. Okay, so there's not any additional key pieces of information that we haven't used yet. So like, for example, in a more geometric problem, like if you already watched the storage container video, in that video you were told the volume of the container has to be 10 cubic feet. So here we're not given anything like that. But there are constraints on our variables. Only certain values are going to make sense for x. So that's like a constraint in itself. So let's think about those values. Let's think about what x could be. Okay, so let's look at our picture and think about the minimum that x could be. Okay, so remember x is the point downriver that she lands. Well, she could just swim directly across the river, right? And then x would be 0. So x could be 0. She could do that. But x couldn't be any less than 0. X couldn't be a negative number. That would make sense in this problem. But 0 is okay. That makes sense. So what's the biggest that x could be? Well, she could swim directly, diagonally to the ice cream shop. And in that case, she would land right at this point. And x would be 150, right? She would land 150 feet downstream. So, okay, that's a possible value. That's kind of the upper limit. X could be 150, but it couldn't be any more. So this is a constraint. X must be between 0 and 150. Okay? Now, our equation is already in terms of one independent variable, so we don't have to do any sort of elimination here. And then the next step is to find the interval of interest for that variable, which we've already done, right? The constraint and the interval of interest, the same thing in this situation. So then our final step is to actually calculate the absolute minimum, in this case, for the equation. So let's go ahead and work through that. Okay, so now we want to take the derivative. In this case, we're trying to find the absolute minimum on a closed interval. So we know that the absolute minimum either occurs at one of the endpoints or at a critical value. So we need to find any critical values that exist so we can test that. I'm going to go through the next few steps kind of quickly. They're not hard. They're just a little tedious, finding these derivatives. Okay, so this, I'm going to rewrite my time equation just to make it a little easier to take the derivative. I'm going to write it like this. 1/6, 30 squared is 900. So I can write this as 1/6, 900 plus x squared to the 1/2 power plus 1/7 times 150 minus x. Okay, so now I'm ready to take the derivative. Okay, 1/6 is the constant. It stays out front. 1/2 comes down. 900 plus x squared to the negative 1/2 times the derivative of the inside. We got the chain rule here, so that's going to be 2x. So that's the derivative of that first term. Second term, 1/7 stays. The derivative inside those parentheses is just negative 1. All right, now we want to clean this up a little bit. We've got a 1/2 and we've got a 2. Those are going to cancel. We've got an x on the top, and on the bottom we've got a 6 square root of 900 plus x squared, and then we've got a minus 1/7. This is our derivative. Okay, so remember we want to find the critical points. So the first thing we want to think of with our critical points are there any points where the derivative does not exist? So looking at this equation, I do notice that this first term has an x in the denominator. Okay, so I want to check that out. But this is the square root of 900 plus x squared. So if you think about it, there's no value of x that's going to make that negative, right? If x is a negative number, it gets squared anyway, so it's positive. If x is 0, the bottom is still positive. So nothing's going to make that denominator 0. So I don't have to worry about that. So then my critical points are going to come. Okay, so let me just make a quick note of what we just said. No x values for which the derivative equals, for which the derivative does not exist. So then what we want to think about is where that derivative equals 0. So then I want to solve this. 0 equals x over 6 times the square root of 900 plus x squared minus 1/7. Okay, move things around a little bit, and we get 1/7 equals x over 6 root 900 plus x squared. Okay, we can use some cross multiplication here to get 6 times this root equals 7x. To get rid of that square root, it's going to be helpful to square both sides. So that's going to give me 36 times the quantity 900 plus x squared equals 49x. Okay, so 36 times 900 gives 32,400 plus 36x squared equals, this should be 49x squared, sorry about that, 49x squared. And then we get 32,400 equals 13x squared. Okay, so 32,400 over 13 equals x squared. So just algebraically from that, there's two possible solutions. We could have the positive root of this, or the negative root. But in terms of the problem, the negative root does not make sense. X is a distance, and it cannot be negative. So we're left with this positive root, which is approximately 49.92. Okay, so what we've done is we found a critical value. Now, is that critical value in our interval of interest? Remember, our interval was from 0 to 150, so it is. Okay, so this is a point we're gonna at which we're gonna want to check and see the value of our function. Okay, so now we're ready to actually check and find the absolute minimum. Okay, so remember once again we're trying to find the absolute minimum on a closed interval. Okay, so it's gonna happen then at either a critical point or an endpoint. Okay, and so we just want to check those three things. So we want to check the time for different x values. So 0 and 150 are endpoints, and this 49.92. And I've gone ahead and plugged these into the calculator to save time, and these are the values we get in seconds. Our units were feet per second, and 24 seconds. Okay, so at this point, we just pick the minimum value out of the list. So I see that the minimum occurs at x equals 49.92. Okay, so let's just ask what the, or see what the question's actually asking. To what point on the opposite bank should she swim to reach the ice cream shop in the least amount of time? Okay, so it's asking for the x value. So as my final answer, I would say something like she should swim about 49.92 feet, we'll say downstream. All right, and that is our final answer in this case. All right, so hopefully now you have a better sense of how to solve this very traditional optimization problem.